Hello guys, this is Cesar Creates and welcome back to my channel! In today's episode we are adding pronghorn antelopes to the Elm Hill City Zoo. If you guys watched my previous episode with Bactrian camels, you already know that we've built this huge shelter for two separate habitats. First one being the camels that we added recently, and I decided to dedicate the second habitat to the pronghorn antelopes. The Bactrian camel habitat was actually a bit inspired by my local zoo and a dromedary camel habitat you can see there. By the way, if you haven't seen that video, I will put the link on the screen and in the description down below. So when it comes to the second habitat, I wanted to make it very similar to the one that we've already built, just because they are so close to each other and they share the shelter together. I knew I wanted to add another ungulate to this area in the zoo because we already had llamas, reindeers and camels, and it just made sense to add another one in here. I knew this habitat will be smaller than the one for the Bactrian camels, so my options were limited. And I also didn't want to include any of the African antelopes of African ungulates because I want to dedicate the whole entire area for African animals. So this is how I came up with pronghorn antelopes. The size of this habitat is perfect for them, and to me they are super interesting and also very beautiful. I feel like pronghorn antelopes are so unique and so not obvious for a zoo game like this. To be honest, as a person from Europe, I wasn't too familiar with this species, and I was quite surprised when I found out that they will be added to this game when it was released. I'm sure that all people from North America are very familiar to this species. I heard about them before and I watched some documentary about animals in North America, but I never thought that they will be added to this game. And I'm very happy that they were actually added because they are super interesting. And thanks to this, I could learn some more things about them. When it comes to this shelter, the guests will have three viewing points for the antelopes. One will be by the main path. I mean, we'll have this main path going through whole zoo. And my concept is that you need to leave this path to see some parts of the zoo, but generally you use it to go around the whole zoo. So one of the viewings will be right next to this path. Another one will be a viewing point like dedicated only for pronghorns down with this gravel path. Guests will be able to enter this very lush and dense quiet area to observe them. And the third one will be on the terrace, on the viewing balcony, where the guests can go and see the view for the whole habitat and also for the Bactrian camel habitat as well. I decided to use the chain link fence for this habitat and also some of these log fences that we have in game. Pronghorn antelopes aren't big and strong animals, so the chain link fence is perfectly fine for them. The log fence is a nice way of keeping their stress level low because they are shy animals, so you don't want your guests to be able to see the whole habitat. There must be some places for the animals to feel more private. And I also used this dry stone wall just as we did with Bactrian camels. It is used by the hill so that the soil from the hill doesn't slide into the habitat. And also thanks to this we are able to create this balcony, because it creates different heights, different levels and very important variation of different terrain. I mean, this variation is very important if you want to go for realistic zoo, because as I said in my other videos, no terrain areas just as huge as zoos are flat. There are always some variations, there are hills, there are holes, there are ditches, and if you want to recreate that, you really should be very good friends with a terrain tool. As you can see, I already started to work a bit on the shelter. I'm basically repeating right now what we did for the camels. I mean, I will finish up the roof, add those columns as we did for the camels, And I will add entrances to this shelter for our antelopes. From the outside, those two parts of the shelter are basically the same, but it will be very different inside, as you guys will be able to see soon. Last time we created the stalls for camels so that they can be closed individually, just like horses in the stable, in stalls for the night, so that they don't bother each other while sleeping. But I felt that, you know, the antelopes, they don't need that. They are very social animals, so they easily can sleep all together in one room. I will only add a gate for one area of this shelter inside, because we created a holding pen just as we did with all other ungulates. This is this small like enclosure that you can see in the back. I told you guys before about the holding pen, what it is used for. Its main function is to separate the animals. For example, when they are sick, when there are some conflicts within the herd, when the mother has just given birth to a small child and they just need some time for themselves, the animals can actually be separated. I also try to repeat that in the shelter so that this holding pen has its own part of the shelter. And thanks to this, animals that are currently in this holding pen, they can actually walk inside their shelter and be closed for a night or when there's bad weather outside. Inside of this shelter, I also used things that we created in previous videos, which are a custom feeder, I mean a feeder that is hanging on the wall, that is very typical for stables, you know, a metal feeder where you can put some branches, some hay for the animals. And we also added automatic water dispenser, which is also very typical for the stables. It is basically an automatic tap for an animal, which an animal needs to push with its nose, for example, for the water to flow. It's also very, very common in stables. And what I've seen when I went through some, you know, shelters, zoo shelters for animals like antelopes, they also use the same mechanism, and I mean the same tops for other animals, not only horses. Because this type of water dispenser is very typical for horse stables. And now I would like to use some time to welcome all the new subscribers to my channel. Our small family is slowly growing and I am so grateful for each and every one of you. The channel has reached 450 subscribers, which is unbelievable for me. There has been a lot of people subscribing lately, and I'm super happy to see all the new faces. I mean, I cannot actually see your faces, but I see by the numbers, and I am super, super grateful. So thank you guys, and I promise to provide you with the best content that I can. And just to let you know, there are a lot of new Planet Zoo and Prehistoric Kingdom videos coming out soon. And if you are new here, welcome, hello. It's very nice to have you here and please consider subscribing, it really helps my channel to grow. With a new Planet Zoo DLC coming out and Prehistoric Alpha also being released last week, this is a very hot season for me and my fellow YouTubers. I mean, we get 8 new animals in a new DLC for Planet Zoo, and I'm sure everyone, including me, will try to record for you guys their versions of habitats for those animals. I will most definitely add some to this Elm Hill City Zoo, but also, as I promised you guys, we'll be soon starting a new zoo. I mean, we are certainly not finished with Elm Hill City Zoo, I just want to start a new zoo with a completely different theme, just to, you know, make things interesting and just to record those videos for you guys from different zoos by turns. So definitely new animals will be added to this zoo and to the new zoo that I will open very, very soon. I mean, we are getting 8 species, that's amazing. Always thought that 5 species per DLC was a bit too less, but now we are getting 8. And I'm super excited about this because maybe it will break this 5 animal pattern, and in the future DLCs we'll also get more animals, which for me is like super exciting, and I keep my fingers crossed. So the 8 new animals that we'll be getting are a clouded leopard, sun bear, proboscis monkey, the binturong, the Malayan tapir, the Usari doll, and the North Sulawesi babirusa, and also a giant Malaysian leaf insect. To be honest, I am most excited about the binturong, the Malayan tapir, and the babirusa, but also a Malaysian leaf insect. It looks very, very nice. Binturong is very interesting climbing animals. I love creating habitats for climbing animals, so I am very excited for it. I know the model looks a bit weird and many people have complaints about this model, but as I already saw, Shantae from Planet Zoo, she's a community manager, and she commented on the forum that they will look into the model of the binturong and maybe they'll like change it a bit. I'm also not a huge fan of the model that they showcased, but anyway, this animal is super interesting and I'm so glad that it was added to the game. Malayan tapir, I love it because it is such a unique animal. It's the only tapir species which lives in Asia. It has those really like interesting colors for animal like this. It is black and white, but those two colors are so saturated. Like there are no like gray areas. It is just black and white, and the contrast between those colors is simply like amazing. We are more used to those contrasts of colors on birds, for example, not actual mammals. So this one is also very exciting for me. And the babirusa, I think, is the most like unique animal. It's just a pig that has those like very weird teeth. Many zoos around the world have it, and I'm also very happy that it was added. The giant leaf insect looks just insane. It looks like a real life giant leaf insect by the screenshot that they showcased. It has a special place in my heart because I remember I always wanted one or couple of them as a child. Maybe not a giant version, but there are also like smaller ones that you can easily buy at pet shops. But my parents simply didn't allow me to buy it because I had so many pets already and I simply cannot blame them. But maybe the right time is now when I live alone. Maybe I should get some. For now I will enjoy them in game, but who knows. So yeah, the new DLC, apparently it doesn't come with any construction pieces like the last DLCs. There is no new foliage, we just get, you know, custom billboards with this update the same day. But anyway, I am equally excited as I was with, other DLCs, because we just simply get 8 animals, which is like insane for me, and finally they listened and they are adding more than just 5. I mean, basically 4, because, you know, one is anyway an exhibit animal, and as we all know, exhibit animals aren't too, like, exciting, unless you are building a reptile house or an insect house or something like this. Yeah, I definitely need to adjust a map which I drew for this Elm Hill City Zoo, so that we have some place for new animals from the new DLC. Also, an alpha version for Prehistoric Kingdom is out, and this game is also simply wonderful. It is similar to Planet Zoo, but it has like completely different vibe for me. I already uploaded my entrance for a park in Prehistoric Kingdom. My new Tropical Valley park is out and it has an entrance, and in case you didn't see it, I will put the link on the screen and in the description down below. Everyone is releasing a lot of Prehistoric Kingdom videos right now, and I will also be one of those persons. So there is a new video from Prehistoric Kingdom coming out very, very soon. I already recorded it, I built a habitat for a first dinosaur. I just need to edit and, you know, add the voiceover, and it will be out very soon on the channel. Also, a new update for Prehistoric Kingdom was released, and it covers a lot of issues that I told you guys about in my first video. So now playing this game is a bit easier for me, and I am super, super happy that it actually was released, because it seems like the developers of this game really listened to the community and they want to provide us with the best experience possible. Okay, but let's go back to today's video. As you can see, I already started to create the habitat for animals. Typical ungulate habitats like antelopes or deers or any other kind of hoofed animals, their habitats in zoos are rather plain and not too exciting, like for example, you know, big cats or monkeys. And this is what I was going for. We need to remember that they actually eat plants, and they spend all their life in this one habitat, so the plants won't get much chance to grow because they would simply eat them. That is why I always add those tree protections, so that you know, animals that eat plants, they don't graze on the tree bark. And that's also the reason why I don't add too many plants to this habitats, while there is a lot of soil and sand, just because that's how basically habitats for those kinds of animals look in real life zoos. The grass gets eaten, the small shrubs, they get eaten. I added some, but it's not too crazy, just some that weren't eaten by animals because they were like, you know, they are new, they just grew out the ground and they animals didn't have a chance to eat them, or for example, the animals simply don't like this kind of plant and it has, you know, some chance to grow. But also, I didn't want to make this habitat too plain and not too boring. I mean, adding rocks and plants to this habitat, it ties it all together, and the rocks and plants, they make everything in this game seem very much prettier. Thanks to them, everything basically is looking better. So if you ever struggle with your habitat, just add those plants and rocks, and I'm sure that will right away look much, much better. As you could see, I created my own custom enrichment for animals. It was like, you know, the logs, four of them that animals can climb, can jump from. It's like really typical one for zoos and for goats and species like this. I also created this additional small shelter. Its main purpose is to protect the feeder for animals from the rain. There is a lot of hay, so animals can actually also lie there and, you know, protect themselves against the sun on the hot days. But it was mainly created to, you know, protect this feeder, and it's also a very common thing to see in the zoos, that the feeder for animals is actually up under some, you know, roof, so that when there's a, you know, rainy day, it's not too soaked in water and it always stays dry. Okay guys, I think that it is time for our fun facts. If you are a subscriber to this channel, you know that in every video I try to give you guys some fun facts about animal that we are currently adding to the zoo. So today's fun facts are about pronghorn antelopes. Pronghorns get their name from the prominent pair of horns they display on the top of their head. They are called pronghorn antelopes, but actually they are not antelopes. They are not related to African antelopes at all. They are the only surviving member of their species family. Actually, their closest living relatives are giraffes and okapi. The pronghorn habitats are mainly plains, basins and deserts of Western North America. They live in Canada, United States and Northern Mexico. Pronghorns can run up to 65 miles per hour, but are not very good jumpers. Pronghorns have very large eyes and they can see 320 degrees around. They actually can eat plants found in the grasslands that are toxic to domestic animals. What is very interesting is that pronghorns are the only species of animals in the world that actually shed their horns annually. I mean, this is typical to reindeers and deer, but they actually shed their antlers. Those things on heads of reindeers and deer are actually called antlers, not horns. Animals like antelopes, they have horns, not antlers, and they don't shed them, they grow their whole life. But the pronghorns are the only exception. They actually shed their horns every year, which is super interesting, and we actually don't know why this happens. Okay, but let's go back to today's video because we are approaching the end. As you could see, I created some of the curbs for the paths. I actually didn't include all the curbs in this video because I didn't want to make it too long, so I just show you guys how I do them. The same goes with the fences for guests around the habitats. This video actually consists a lot of, you know, work around this habitat because I know you guys like to watch this part, because I know that decorating the area around the habitat might be challenging, and that's why I wanted to show you guys how I do it. So I included some work that I normally do around habitats in this video. So of course, beside info boards and curbs and fences, there is also foliage, there is a lot of rocks. There are some fences or protections for guests. I use those, you know, additional barriers for guests, so it will be like, you know, more difficult for them to reach an actual fence of the habitat. I see this a lot in zoos, and actually it is used so that, you know, the guests won't put their hands or fingers inside the habitats, because animals can simply bite them or harm them in any other way. Of course, if they will be determined to do so, I mean, the guests, you know, touch the fence, they'll be able to do it, but that's just this first boundary that, you know, keeps them thinking if they actually should do it, if it's worth it. And I always try to include this in my videos. In a second, I will start to add a lot of foliage around this habitat. Although it's a city zoo, I try to make it very lush, because I also think that, you know, plants make animals feel better, like more safe and more hidden away from the guest site. And because of the lush plants, there are only some viewing areas where the guests are actually able to see the animals. I also created a small pond near the crossing of the paths, and I wanted to make it very green and lush, just something nice for the eye for the guests that will be passing it by. I mean, there are a lot of like nature scenes also in the zoos, and that's basically the first one that we created, but there'll be more in the future in this zoo for sure. Okay guys, that is all that I have for you today. Please enjoy the rest of this video and stay till the end. There'll be some cinematic shots of the habitat that we've built today. Please subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. You'll be able to see me build more of those realistic habitats, and also you'll be able to get some inspiration for your virtual zoos. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a big thumbs up, ring the bell if you want to be notified every time I upload a new video, and also comment down below if you enjoyed this video, or if you simply have some recommendations on how I can improve my future videos. Thank you guys for watching, have a wonderful day, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye guys!